The White House calling off a possible meeting between U.S. President Joe Biden and his Russian counterpart Vladimir Putin for now. It says Russia should first move to de-escalate tensions before talks can be considered.
At this point, that is certainly not in the plans.
And what would it take to get that conversation back to the table, to reconsider a meeting between the two leaders?
Well, de-escalation. That's what it would take.
Which, how do you define that?
De-escalation means moving troops. It means de-escalating from what the steps they continue to take on a daily basis appear to be.
U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken also cancels a meeting with Russia's foreign minister over recent developments in Ukraine.
Last week, I agreed to meet Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov this week on February 24th to discuss our country's respective concerns about European security, but only if Russia did not invade Ukraine. Now that we see the invasion is beginning, and Russia has made clear its wholesale rejection of diplomacy, it does not make sense to go forward with that meeting at this time.
The U.S. hits back as Russia brings Europe closer to the brink of war. The U.S. slapping harsh sanctions aimed at punishing Moscow for what President Joe Biden called the beginning of a Russian invasion of Ukraine. Here's the full story.
This is the beginning of a Russian invasion of Ukraine.
Calling out what he said were illegal acts, U.S. President Joe Biden on Tuesday announced the first round of new sanctions against Moscow, adding to Western efforts to stop what some fear is the beginning of a full-scale invasion of Ukraine.
To put it simply, Russia just announced that it is carving out a big chunk of Ukraine. This is a flagrant violation of international law and demands a firm response from the international community.
One of the worst security crises in Europe in decades is unfolding as Russian President Vladimir Putin sends what he calls peacekeeping troops to the separatist areas of Donetsk and Luhansk after recognizing them as independent.
I'm going to begin to impose sanctions in response far beyond the steps we and our allies and partners implemented in 2014.
Biden said sanctions are being applied to VEB Bank and Russia's military bank. Starting on Wednesday, U.S. sanctions will begin against Russian elites and their families.
They share in the corrupt gains of the Kremlin policies and should share in the pain as well.
Earlier on Tuesday, Germany put the brakes on a new gas pipeline from Russia, and Britain also hit Russian banks with sanctions. The Russian Foreign Ministry criticized the new measures as illegitimate. The European Union agreed to new sanctions aimed at politicians, lawmakers, and officials, banning EU investors from trading in Russian state bonds, and targeting imports and exports with separatist entities. Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov earlier brushed off the threat of sanctions, but Biden warned worse was to come if Russian aggression continues.
Australia and Japan joining the long list of countries imposing sanctions against Russia. Australia will begin placing sanctions on Russian individuals it believes were responsible over the country's actions against Ukraine.
Australians always stand up to bullies, and we will be standing up to Russia along with all of our partners, like-minded, and all of those who believe that it is absolutely unacceptable that Russia could invade its neighbour. The sanctions will impose strong economic sanctions in the regions of Luhansk and Donetsk, targeting the following sectors: transport, energy, telecommunications, oil, gas, and mineral reserves.
As for Japan, it will prohibit the issuance of Russian bonds in the country. It will also freeze the assets of certain Russian individuals. Ukraine's military reports intensified shelling in the eastern Luhansk region. They say Russian-backed separatists have been firing mortar launchers, anti-tank grenade launchers, and machine guns in a frontline town for several days now. Satellite imagery over the past 24 hours also shows several new troop and equipment deployments in western Russia and vehicles at a small airfield in southern Belarus, which borders Ukraine. The United Nations now calling for a ceasefire.
when troops of one country enter the territory of another country without its consent, they are not impartial peacekeepers. They are not peacekeepers at all. The United Nations, in line with the relevant Security Council and General Assembly resolution, stands fully behind the sovereignty, political independence, and territorial integrity of Ukraine within its international recognized borders. We need restraint and reason. We need de-escalation now.
Ukraine's president calls up the country's reservists as Russia ratchets up tensions. In an address to the Ukrainian people, President Volodymyr Zelensky ruled out a general mobilization for now. But his decision to bring back reservists into active duty shows Ukraine is bracing for a possible war with Russia. Ukraine's leader adds he's still pursuing a diplomatic way out of the crisis, asserting the country would not cede any territory to Moscow. The Philippine government begins moving Filipinos in Ukraine to safer areas as tensions between Moscow and Kiev escalate. The Overseas Workers Welfare Administration, or OWA, is offering relocation and voluntary repatriation programs for Filipinos there. Six OFWs from Ukraine have returned to the Philippines earlier this month. Two more Filipinos have availed of the repatriation program. There are over 300 Filipinos currently living in Ukraine. The Ukrainian community in Canada on edge as fears grow over a possible Russian invasion of their home country. They're calling for more actions from the West in the face of Russian aggression.
If Russia were to start a war with Ukraine, then I would expect all Western allies, the European Union, all NATO countries to send troops and aid. Not just monetary aid, not just weapons, but actual physical bodies.
Putin seems to be interested in something like a 19th century conquest. He wants to conquer Ukraine, he wants to deprive it of its independence, and that is a madman's plan.
Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, meanwhile, announced sanctions against Russia. He's also urging Russian President Vladimir Putin to return to the negotiating table and avert a full-blown war.
If Putin thinks it is in his interest to invade another sovereign country, we have to demonstrate to him that it is not in his interest, that he will not come through this better or stronger. That this is harming Russia. Russia needs to stand down. It needs to understand that there are consequences for a country that chooses to use force to violate fundamental precepts of international law that has kept our world remarkably stable for many, many decades.